also have had to pull ahead recently the gigafactory schedule to supply the cells and battery packs into the Model 3 as well. So what that means is that our earlier schedule for the gigafactory that we communicated as the 35 gigawatt hours of cells and 50 gigawatt hours of packs in 2020, we've had to pull that ahead by 2 years. So in 2018, we have to be at 35 gigawatt hours of cell production to support that volume of Model 3s. And you can sort of see the evidence of that around you, I hope, as you're walking around the factory. But we're pulling ahead construction, we're pulling ahead equipment installation, and Panasonic has absolutely done their part to stay in sync with us as we've accelerated the schedules for Model 3. So I think that's one of the big stories of what you see going on around you out here, both the construction on the pad and then also the equipment installation inside the building. But other than that, it's very exciting to open the doors a little bit and have you guys see behind the curtain for the first time. We haven't had too many people out here. So you're one of the very first people that get to, actually some of the first that get to actually see parts of the factory that have been closed off until now. So we're pretty excited to show that off.
Is there anything you'd like to add?
Well, I just want to explain to you, kind of the relationship between the Tesla and the Panasonic. I used to be in charge of the components business, device business, 5 or 6 years ago. At that time, we started the business with the Tesla. At that time, our relationship is to say supplier and buyer type of relationship, conventional business relationship of the components and the devices. But since we started the discussion on the gigafactory, that's completely changed. Not really supplier-buyer relationship at all. It's a real one team, Tesla people and the Panasonic team. One example, Elon mentioned, production capacity, originally thinking certain amount, but now probably twice or three times more. Why it happens? Because Tesla people, factory people, now engineering, manufacturing people worked together, original plan. However, discussing these details, they came up with the ideas how to increase productivity, efficiency, faster. They invented what happened was, right now we can assume within this factory we can produce probably twice or three times than original thought. This type of relationship is quite new in business, not really simple buyer and supplier type of relationship. And we are very excited to see this gigantic factory. And today I'm sure you already went through factory tour. But what you saw today, just a part of Gigafactory. Years from now, if you come back after 20, you will see total difference. Much more is moving, working, and much more machineries. And so that's all.
All right, so just have a couple of questions. Good.
Sure. Can I wait for Mike?
I'm just saying.
It's pretty loud, right?
Yeah.
Joe White with Reuters. First of all, this is a substantial, impressive investment. It's not the only substantial impressive investment that you talked about, Elon. You outlined a strategic plan last week. What are the elements of that plan? Cost, inclusive of over but here? How are you going to fund it?
I wanted to state what the build costs are. Well, you have to say, how much is it going to cost over what period of time? And then what part of that is coming from Tesla versus strategic partners like Panasonic and some other sort of much smaller scale strategic partners. We're seeing very good participation from our suppliers in the capital cost of Model 3 round. And we expect to essentially fund it with Model S and X revenue, with money we have right now, potentially with a modest capital raise, but I wouldn't say a significant. That's basically what we need. Basically, in a nutshell, maybe there's a minor capital raise, but it's not a
just a quick follow-up. So the strategic plan you outlined last week, there's analysts have estimated $2 to $3 billion for the different vehicles that you proposed. Is that a number that aligns with numbers you have in your head or that you have on paper, or what do you think that costs?
No, I don't think that's right. It's more to look at per unit time. Once the Model 3 program is up and running, at full production, that program is a $20 billion a year program in terms of revenue. So, you know, if it's got a 25% gross margin or something like that, it's a $5 billion a year cash contribution margin. So obviously it's possible to fund quite a bit with that. So that it's not like all those vehicles will happen simultaneously, or the capital associated with those will happen simultaneously. It would happen over time. And the over time number is quite a bit more than $2 to $3 billion. And ultimately, you know, what is the mass price that we would expand to all of the major segments for vehicles? This will obviously be in the tens of billions. Yeah, that's right, necessarily. But it's important, people like say, you know, most of the money headline says they expect to spend tens of billions of dollars right now instead of being correct. But over time, this must necessarily be true.
Elon? Phil Lebeau with CNBC.
So it's hard to see where you are. Over here. Because I'd see it before I come from those dots this end.
When will the Gigafactory start producing battery packs for Tesla vehicles? And at this point, are you saying you believe you're on schedule to meet the capacity needed for the 500,000 vehicles for annual production by 2018? With the battery production from here to meet that?
Yeah, I think we are on track to meet the 500,000 in 2018. In fact, like the hardest thing to predict is really the ramp, because the ramp looks like an S-curve and it grows exponentially. So initially the ramp looks really tiny, and then as you eliminate bottlenecks, you climb the ramp and then you level off. So it's always historically been very difficult for us to forecast the exact shape of the S-curve of the production ramp. But it's been much easier for us to forecast where things will be steady state. So I feel actually we're pretty good about forecasting in 2018, whereas 2017 is much more in the air just because of the necessary uncertainties associated with a complex production ramp.
In first production, the first packs for vehicles coming out of here?
We're probably for vehicles, I'd say it's 8 or 9 months.
Okay.
Yeah, we're pretty close. Probably like in the March, April time frame next year, is when we start producing packs for early production vehicles that needs to then go through validation testing and then be ready for around basically July, August next year.
Yeah, maybe it's obvious, but all the Model 3 packs would be built here. So even those development packs, qualification packs, and then of course the beginning of the production ramp.
So if you say development packs, it's even sooner than that, maybe 6 months. And there's a lot of activity for Tesla Energy, for the Powerwall and Powerpack stuff. That's what we've done here. So that's, you know, the stationary storage front. You know, that's something which I think will probably be as big as the car business long term. And we'll actually have a growth rate of probably several times that of what the car business is per year. I think that the growth in stationary storage is really underappreciated. And that's a super exponential growth rate.
Do you have sort of expectations of sales of the stationary battery pack, like, you know, gigawatt hours next year? Or can you give us a sense of that growth curve?
Yeah, what we sort of roughly assumed is that you know, that's probably a third to initially kind of maybe a third of what vehicle output is. So, but then with the growth rate is faster, so it would then grow it to probably match roughly what vehicle output is. So, and this is a very rough guess. And again, because of the difficulty of guessing where you are on an exponential growth curve, if you move the dates around even slightly, you can change the numbers dramatically. it's probably north of 10 gigawatt hours in 2018, something like that. But like I said, just imagine you're trying to put eight brackets around an exponential curve. It's like, you move that just a little bit and it makes a big difference.
And then,
but ultimately, we're doing 50 to 100 gigawatt hours of stationary storage or more.
And last year at the Edison Electric Institute, you talked about the sort of split between the power pack and the power wall.
Yeah.
It sounded like 80% of sales would be the bigger battery version versus about 20% of the power wall. Do you still see that split, or do you see that?
Well, the difference between like the gigawatt hours and the unit sales. So the total unit volume of the power wall will be much greater than the power pack.
Okay.
The power pack is like a heavy industrial thing. The power pack is like, for maybe most people, that looks like kind of like a recent refrigerator.
Yeah.
Whereas the power wall is like a very compact, and will get even more compact over time, such that it can be put anywhere in a house or on the outside of a house, and you can tuck away many purposes there. But roughly, I think it is like one power pack is about 10 power walls. So, it's difficult to say exactly where things net out. In some countries, it's going to be really different. Some countries can be heavily weighted towards the consumer side, and some will be heavily weighted towards the utility industrial side. It depends on what the price structure is for a given country. So the fundamental cost structure of power generation remains true almost anywhere in the world. Unless you're in a highly normal situation, like if you have access to very high levels of hydro electric or something like that. But for most countries, the problem of power generation, the cost structure is always true. But it's not always true that cost structure is passed through to the end users. So